cameras and all that sort of thing, and I kind of took a slightly different route. So I want to introduce you to the KSLMS. I have to give credit to somebody else, to Alicia, for that photograph, because I didn't do it. So basically, where this is coming from is, some of you might have heard about the Netflix stuff where they have their Chaos Monkey and their Simian Army, which is actually quite an interesting idea. Like, their Chaos Gorilla is this process they run underlying systems that occasionally will just wipe out an entire availability zone. Chaos Monkey will take, I think, their EC2 servers and just kill them at random, just for giggles. The idea being, obviously, that if your system can cope with that, it can cope with normal failures. So that's basically what they call chaos engineering. So I have two questions that normally people ask when I say this. You want to do what? And then the other one is, what do you mean in production? It's, if you're asking those questions, you probably don't trust your system already. And that's probably an indication that something's wrong. It's one of those things most people, when I say it to them, they take a sharp intake of breath, and then a few minutes later they're going, well, actually, maybe that isn't a bad idea. And I'm hoping it isn't. But the reason we have this is distributed systems are just chaotic. There's a huge number of states, I almost remember. There's a huge number of states that can get into. Failure can just happen all the time. Like, we had a situation about a week and a half ago where all our lambdas stopped working. And what had happened was, AWS had obviously decided that something was over-provisioned or running out of capacity, moved our lambdas to a different IP range, and the XML gateway here was starting to block all our lambdas when they're trying to talk to Strata. How I would have picked that up in testing, I have no idea. But that's the whole point. Some of these things are only going to come out in production. So it's, you saw the Simian Army, this stuff's all kind of being done for the Docker containers getting deployed in EC2 and all that sort of stuff. And I started wondering, well, how can you do that with a Lambda? Because I can't force AWS's Lambda system to crash. And if I could, I probably would get lynched by a lot of people. So there's a thing in Lambdas called aliases and versions. And one of the things you can do is, if you have an alias, say live, you can say, route 90% of the traffic to version 3 and 10% of the traffic to version 2. So what I started thinking is, well, what happens if version 2 is just a separate code deployment? It's got nothing to do with what actually the Lambda is doing, but that just fails. And that's basically what I did. So what happens is, when you deploy this, it installs a version of the Lambda. Now, that version of the Lambda is not the code the Lambda you want to run, it's just basically a five-line Lambda that just throws an error. And then I set up an alias that kind of goes, right, 90% of the traffic goes to the one we actually want to run, 10% goes to the error. Now, the reason I did that is, what I didn't want to do is, I didn't want to put into my production Lambda code that says, fail every so often. I wanted the bit that failed separate from the actual code. So, figured out I could do that. I did it manually. We don't like doing things manually. It's hard to reproduce. So I started thinking about, how could I do this automatically? So I could put in a code pipeline thing, another stage in code pipeline, because like Paul's squad, because to be honest, we nicked most of their architecture. Like Paul's squad, we use code pipeline, so I could put in an extra stage at the end. Or you could use CloudWatch. So what I've written as a proof of concept is a Lambda that can be triggered by CloudWatch that installs itself on another Lambda. So the CloudWatch events I'm triggering off are when you update a Lambda alias. So when you update an alias, so you put a new version on, you've updated where live is pointing, this thing triggers off, and it kind of changes that alias so that 10% of the traffic is going to the error one. Now, I know somebody at some point is going to point out, well, hang on, this is getting triggered off an update, and then you're updating, and you could get into a bit of a loop. I think of, did I lose everybody there? There's a lot of faces. Right. I'm triggering off when you're updating a lambda, and then getting my lambda to update that alias, which is also an update. So you could get yourself into a cycle, and I could run up CDL a huge bill if I'm not careful. I haven't put this in live yet. I think I'll cope with that. I am going to talk with Josh or somebody in the cloud team before I actually try this. But so I have this lambda here, and it has an alias live, and if I test it, if I click the right button to test it, it'll succeed, and all it does is return basically a hello from lambda, kind of message for, it's kind of set up for an API gateway. And if you look down here, you can see that this alias, this live alias, just calls version 4 of the lambda. So this other lambda I have here, which, oh, this had better be loud. This other lambda, because I don't have my phone either, is the one that I would trigger from the CloudWatch event. So if I just trigger this, give it a second. If I go back in here now, and we look at live, hopefully, you can see that it's now saying version 4 gets 90% of the traffic, version 12 gets 10. And what it's actually done in the background is it's gone in, it's checked what aliases there's there, so it's looked for one called Chaos Llama. If there is one called Chaos Llama, it just points the 10% to that. If there isn't one, it installs it. That's where the version 12 just came from. And so now when I run this, and this may take more than one click. So, it's still working. This is where we get into probability. How long is this gonna take? Come on. This will fail, I swear. There we go. And the standard error message is the Chaos Llama strikes again. So we now have something that will fail, and I haven't kind of put in all the tweaks, but you can set the error message via environmental variables and whatnot. So just to finish off on this, there are one or two, I'm not going to bother putting this back on the screen, you can see it, one or two issues. Because I'm installing with the other lambda, it has to be language specific. I can't install a JavaScript version of this Chaos Llama with a Java lambda, because the runtime wouldn't accept it, obviously. You have to have a standard endpoint, because one of the things you do when you create a lambda is you say, this is the function you start with. So it has to be the same, because you can't change that for different versions. But to be honest, we write most of our lambdas in one language, and all of them are structured more or less the exact same. As a team, you just tend to get into a structure for these things. shared environmental variables, what I mean by that is, I've put it so that you can put custom error message in the environmental variable, but because they're basically getting deployed together, those environmental variables have to be set for everything, basically. So, it does work. I never giggled evilly quite as much as I was writing this. I got to write a piece of clean code with a method called deploy the herd, which is the first time I've ever seen that. And I am fully intending, when I'm sure I'm not going to get into some loop that will cause lambdas to run completely out of control, to actually put in that CloudWatch thing, so every time anybody deploys in the Symfony stuff, this gets attached. As well, I should say, just to give myself an out, it does look at the tags on the lambda, and it's basically looking for chaos true before it actually installs. So I'm giving myself an out in case the cloud team need to install stuff. I don't want to be, but I'm not sure I should be kind of messing around with their lambdas. And that's it. Yes.
Just a thought, but do you know that Chernobyl was caused by inducing a deliberate failure?
No. That makes me more apprehensive, but I think I'm probably safe from causing that level of damage.
I think we should set our own chaos monkeys and gorillas and
I think that the only thing, the only reason why I wouldn't say we could do that now is for some of our things anyway, we're not sure where they're going to get deployed. I'm still not sure where Chorus is going to get deployed. It's going to be in a customer account, it's going to be in a separate. And until you know how your thing's going to be set up, I'm not sure you're going to be getting very valid results out of that. But yeah, there's, I would love to be able to get API gateways doing the same thing, but their canary deployments would make that a bit more difficult. Getting your system to fail, I know this is going to sound weird, getting your system to fail reliably is probably a good thing, man. And that's why I started looking at it, because, yeah. As I said, I'd love to be able to do API gateways, I just haven't figured out how to do that because... Maybe? Possibly, I can follow that. What he said. It's the serverless stuff that... it seems to be, the chaos engineering stuff seems to be very well set out for, you've got a server, let's just nuke it. It's the serverless stuff where people don't seem to have done as much kind of, because it's, people tend to in AWS when they're talking about Lambdas, they just seem to assume they're reliable, they'll always be there, that the network bandwidth is kind of more or less infinite to all the other AWS services, and as we've seen occasionally it's not, and it's just, these errors might naturally only occur once every 6 months. But by that time, your stuff's probably in production and that error is causing a problem. If that error happens during your dev cycle, then that's a much better place for it to be happening. So yes, as I said, it's going to get installed in our account as soon as I make sure that I don't run up a huge bill. Okay? I'm going to dodge it.